Having covered the origins of the eukaryotes and multicellularity, I now want to turn to another form of symbiosis. We're still looking at endosymbiosis to begin with, where one species lives inside another. I mean, mitochondria, chloroplasts, those are endosymbiotic, where the single-celled bacteria live inside the cell wall of the protist and then the eukaryote. But they're also gut symbionts. And this is where animals now, multicellular organisms, still have small organisms living inside their digestive system. So an extraordinary example of gut symbionts involves the termites. People don't like termites very much because they can eat our houses because they can eat wood. But how do they digest the wood? It turns out that the digestion of the wood depends on their gut symbionts. So inside the digestive system of a termite, there are these protozoa called trichonympha. And if we look closely inside, we see here inside the tummy of the termite are the trichonympha, okay? Now, the protozoa then takes the wood chip that's been chewed off by the termite, come into its tummy, protozoa now engulfs the wood chip, and it has bacteria in its own gut. So the bacteria in the gut of the protozoa is actually what digests the cellulose. So only the bacteria living inside the protozoa can synthesize cellulase, which digests the cellulose in wood. Gut symbionts are everywhere. Cattle graze in the paddock in the South 40, and they're chewing up and ingesting a lot of cellulose, but they cannot digest it. Okay? Now, cattle have a special digestive organ called the rumen. And in the rumen, there's a lot of bacteria that, again, can synthesize cellulase. And so the cellulose in the straw and hay that the cow eats are broken down by bacteria in the cow's rumen. And hey, it's not just cows. Our guts contain 100 trillion microorganisms. We have vast numbers of bacteria living in our intestines, okay? That's 10 times as many cells as we have in our own bodies. So if you're just counting up cells, we are mostly gut symbionts being carried around by this animal shell, okay? So look inside, close up of the intestinal wall, and there are masses of bacteria there, okay? And they help us to digest our food. Now, it turns out that even though we're all very compulsive about keeping our food clean, we actually need a certain amount of bacteria in our diet so that it can help us to digest whatever we eat. Okay? Now, every now and then, the ecosystem of bacteria in our digestive system gets all out of whack. Maybe we eat some contaminated food that has some really nasty bacteria that doesn't work well with others, and it may spread at the expense of the healthy bacteria. And so then we may want to take an antibiotic because we know the antibiotics will kill off the bacteria in our guts, and that may help us out. But it may not always help out because the antibiotics not only kill the unwanted bacteria, antibiotics can kill those healthful bacteria that we need to digest our food. So this animation here, a cartoon here, shows you various sequences about how important it is to have a healthy digestive system. But if you have your antibiotics, perhaps you're going to kill off your healthy ones. So one way to restore a healthy ecosystem in our bacteria is to borrow the bacteria from somebody else. Yes, that's right. If you can find a stool donor, okay, and inject the bacteria from somebody else's intestines, okay, that can then go in and restore the right balance of healthy bacteria in your own colon. Okay? And this, I expect to see, will become more and more common as people are only now recognizing the extraordinary value of all those endosymbionts, of all those bacteria that we need to be healthy. So fecal transplants, we already know, are more effective than antibiotics for treating infections with a nasty bug called Clostridium. And there are likely to be many other uses for these kinds of fecal transplants. Now, mother's milk, you'd think, is perfectly evolved to help the digestion of her baby, because that's all it's going to eat for its first few months of life. But one of the puzzles that's been present in the analysis of mother's milk is that 21% of a mother's milk consists of complex sugars that the babies are unable to digest themselves. They don't have the enzymes to do it. But it turns out that in the baby's gut, there's Bifidobacterium longum. And these sugars can be digested by Bifido. Okay? So it turns out that by feeding the baby these sugars that the baby itself cannot digest, the mother is nurturing a very healthy bacterial flora inside her child's gut. Okay? And this healthful bacteria prevents infection by much more harmful bacteria. People are now in a position to assay the extraordinary diversity of bacteria that lives in different parts of our bodies. And if you look at all the different kinds of bacteria in our intestines, you can see the genetic relationships between them all, those that live in our air passages, in our lungs, those in our mouth. These are all related to each other, but there are lots of diversity, lots of different kinds of bacteria. And it turns out that there's a real advantage from a natural birth as opposed to a cesarean section, because the baby needs bacteria in the birth canal to protect it against asthma and allergies. By getting exposure to the bacteria during a natural birth, then the child is now inoculated with healthful bacteria that keep its airways and many other parts of its bodies healthy. Likewise, the gut has this extraordinary number of bacteria that are endosymbiotic, and all those 100 trillions of cells, all the different diversity of bacteria contain a total of over 3 million different genes. And I mean, our bodies are coded with only 20,000 genes. So the true genetic diversity that we're carrying around with us in our gut, in our bacteria, is far greater than that that produce fingers and hair and eyeballs. Bacteria in our nose actually make antibiotics that can kill inhaled pathogens. So over and over again, we look at different parts of the body, we have symbiotic relationships, mutualistic advantage, very healthful in the bacteria that protect us against unwanted, more parasitic forms of bacterial infection. Now, that's all endosymbiotic, where it's living inside the body. More generally, we see symbiosis can occur between organisms that can be physically separated for much of the time and then come into direct contact, but only touch each other on the outer surfaces. I just want to give a couple examples of these, lichen and mycorrhizae. Now, lichen, you see on the rocks, you might see it on an old statue, where you have these little colorful flakes. And these turn out to be symbionts, that you have a fungus that provides the physical structure, and then little kind of clasping structures that hold on to bits of green algae. The green algae then is capable of photosynthesis, providing organic molecules for the growth of the fungus. And then the fungus, besides providing a place to live, can extract some minerals from the rocks and give important nutrients to the plants. This relationship between the fungus and the algae is so important that when they get ready to disperse and form a new lichen, there's a tiny bit of fungus attached around each individual algae as they disperse through the air. Mycorrhizae are extraordinary in that, again, we have a symbiotic relationship now between plants and fungus. The fungus with their mycelia, those really tiny little tendrils, in this case now enshroud the roots, individual roots of a plant, and they deliver to the plant soil nutrients because they can extract minerals from the dirt, and then in exchange they receive carbohydrates from the plant. And so if you actually pull up a flowering plant, you'll see a lot of cottony material around the roots. That's the mycorrhizae, it's the fungus. And this is such an important thing for the nutrition and the security of the plant that almost every different species of flowering plant has its own fungus that lives with it in the form of mycorrhizae. So Virtually every species of flowering plant has its own species of mycorrhizae. Symbiosis, then, is fundamental to the health of multicellular organisms.